You know, it still blows my mind that the Commodore 64 can do digital audio. And if it wasn't for Mahoney, the fellow that discovered this technique about 10 years ago, this project would not be possible. His method makes digital audio on the Commodore 64 easy and great sounding. It's amazing. It's not like, hey, taxi, remember that game? Yeah, no, this is good stuff. And the fact that I can pull it off in addition to playing a video at the same time, wow, it just blows my own mind. Anyway, so what else is in this episode here? Well, we are dealing with Commodore 64 after all, so I only got about 1 million cycles in a second. It's not really enough to do the digital audio and the video at the same time. So I'm starting to look for shortcuts, ways to make things efficient. There's a lot of, you know, debating, thoughts. Yeah, mostly me talking, but yeah, that's what most of these episodes are, eh? So whatever, let's watch.
The audio rollout, whatever, worked. It is not able to play at 8 kilohertz audio. It's occasionally glitching out. Well, and it's also out of sync because the video is falling behind and lots of reasons. Ta-da!
What? No, it never crossed my mind.
But just for a moment there,
ha-ha.
Didn't you think that I'd be pretty good to eat?
Well. It's just so satisfying. So now I got to find a way to either make sure there is time to burn, a little more efficient is what I need. Oh man, it's such a relief. This is the two character set version. Now, I know I can go back to the single. It does a lot less bringing in, a lot less work. And it will play this, no problem, I'm sure. But I want the two character sets to work. What do I do next? Man, I don't want to spoil you guys and play all the audio parts. You know, that's, I guess, you've been patient enough. Unless you went and found this show on your own. You don't know what they're talking about. It's just cool. Whatever. I'm pumped. This finished in the middle of the night. I got out of bed, shut it down, and that was it. But yeah, now it works. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. I got. Well, it is a bright morning. I think it's time for some food. I'll figure out my next move later. Just to give you an idea of how it is really screwing up.
May?
Yes?
You're pretty busy looking this way and that way, kiddo.
Lots of guys have seen him, but none of them have been eaten up, have they?
Then I'm gonna get you!
And that's how it ends. Yeah, not cool. I'll figure this out. Okay, I added I added some coloring to the digis on the way in and out. I also added the redirect so it stays synchronized with the bad lines once per frame. And I got the volume turned off. As you can see, the bad lines are still affecting it. This is my bad. I can relocate that so it won't happen there. I'm going to try that right away. See what this looks like. Yeah, better. I removed, like on most of the back bit, I had a bunch of knobs to begin the interrupt somewhere where I could see it. But this is a different beast, right? So it's doing it a little differently. But I'm not sure if I even want to bother because there now, it caught up. It sounds just as good with the bad lines in place than without. But you see how it just messes up just a little. Neat. don't really understand it all, but it's still neat. Okay, for now, what I've done is I went back to the PC, the video editor, Audacity. I made a new clip of the audio that goes 15 seconds beyond the footage into silence. And I also changed line 70 to be this. Hopefully that still works. So, I mean, that's not really checking for the end properly. It's like, okay, if something's effed, end it, right? And, yeah, so it's writing to the BBT because the super CPU, come on, do it. Oh, man. Whoa, that's slow. Yeah. But I was working on rollout audio 1.3, which is going to use my fast bucket sort, because I got a feeling once I'm done this, it's not going to be synchronized even if I get it working properly. So I'm going to have to re-roll it out many times to tweak the speed just right. And how I plan to do that is once the video plays without losing a frame or glitching out, and say the audio ends here, I want to make it synchronized perfectly. So to do that, I have to figure out how much over it goes, and basically say it'll bring in 81 bytes, and then 82 it'll disregard, and then bring in the next 81. You know what I mean? So it'll kind of pull one out every so often and squish the rest together. And that's how I plan to synchronize this. Because the audio, you can fudge quite a bit before it's noticeable. And as for the video, one of the things I plan to do, because the raster tells the thing when it's time for new frame, at the same time, that's when it goes crazy and does all the color. Well, why not just take where the color RAM, packed color RAM, is meant to be unpacked from, take that single value, put it into a mailbox, and the main loop looks at that mailbox and goes, ah, crap, now I have to do this. That way, the task of updating the color is taken out of the interrupt. And if it puts something in the mailbox and it's busy doing another color, and it puts something else in the mailbox, it's going to cover up one of the previous ones. Whatever. You're going to lose. You have to lose. It can't possibly just do everything. That might be a good way to keep this in sync. And another trick that I plan to use to save at least one cycle per interrupt, and it isn't doing the demo coder trick, because I want the super CPU to play along. So I'm possibly going to put the sound routine into zero page. I'll find a place for it. Maybe I'll just copy all of zero page somewhere else and then put it back when I exit, because zero page should be for me. As long as the interrupts aren't using it or anything, I think that's free. I could use that. In fact, I might even be able to put the color unpacker into zero page. Ooh. And as it is, I can't show you right now because it's running this, but the color unpacker is using, like bracket something, comma, Y. Indirect indexed. Yes. That takes 5 cycles on a read, 6 cycles on a write, but I can use self-modifying code and absolute indexed, which is 4 on a read, 5 on a write, and it will be a little faster as well. So there's ways to save here. I'm going to look into that. But right now I basically got this started for two reasons. One, it'll get it done so I can start, tweaking a little more without having it worrying about crashing when it hits the end. Because what I think it's doing, I was fudging the audio the first time. I didn't know when the end was. So it's probably executing code in nowhere land. My bad. And the second reason is, now I can play Fall Guys. But I will have the book open for between levels and possibly work on some code. So that's a good compromise. All right, peace. Well, a few hours later, oops. Yeah, I think I forgot to load in the magic tables. Crap, I get to do it again and go back to playing PlayStation. This is the beginning of the audio digi. This is supposed to be zeros and 30s. Like, 30 hex, which are the Mahoney equivalents of 127 and 128. So it just flipped whatever. It used whatever gibberish was there as the index. Yeah, big oops. It took about an hour and 50 to do this, and then I kept playing my game for another hour, so I get to go back. But yeah, stupid. It helps to get everything, all your ducks in order before you throw the bowling ball at them, you know? I'm trying different things out with the audio here. I've also come up with a way to put this into zero page if I wanted to. It'll save me one cycle per, but I don't know if I'm going to. This is playing very well at the moment. I've had some experiences where it's incredibly choppy. So I'm testing out my old Wolves in the BackBit where it tracks the queue up access times in cycles and whether there's a frame introduced during that wait. I'm just waiting for a good section where it's messing up, then I'll bust out of here because it's still recording all the data for me. And I have a tiny little program that I can load up to look at it. But yeah, this is too well. I could slow the audio down, put in a different bit rate, and it'll work fine. It won't drop any frames. I also tried the mailbox technique where the color was put into the main loops problem. And that worked well. It dropped very few frames. Like, it was more or less just keeping right up, but the color would screw up even more. It's technical, I guess. I don't really understand it enough. I'm still experimenting. I just thought I'd better make a clip here or the whole night's just going to be undocumented. And likewise, here's some crude results from what you just saw. Cycles of access for the audio, for the video, and the little ones indicate a new frame was introduced during that time, which explains why, in this case, it's significantly longer than that. And this, well, a little bit longer than those two, because it's still got to do all the color. That's still happening by interrupt for these times. More experimenting continues. I'm glad I'm not sick of this clip. And I can just go bust it in here, change stuff all I want. So there, that is now... This is what it is at 16 kilohertz audio. Yeah, but that just shows you that it doesn't work. Okay, so how do we get back in here? Got to reload the monitor because it got killed, right? Get back in there. Where are we? I think it was this one. So let's say we simulate, say, approximately. No. There. Somewhere around 11 kilohertz audio. You see, it actually might work. Well, not with this. I doubt it, because I don't think I can slim this code down enough, because the wild card, the unpredictable bit, is the BBT access times. But with the single character set version, I could probably make the video slightly worse and the audio slightly better. But I'm still experimenting, just showing you what I'm doing. All right, back I go. Here's one clever way to save some time on my color unpacker. When you do get a valid byte that's negative, part of it goes here and part of it goes there. They're two separate pointers, right? And of course, since it's a packed byte, you kind of have to shuffle it over to get that. Well, 2, 4, 6, 8 cycles just to do that, right? But the value is in Y, right? And now it's 6 cycles. If I make a 256 byte table where basically, you got the low and the high or whatever, and you know what I'm saying, right?
Because I'm not saying it. I hope you know what I'm saying without saying it. This will be 6 cycles when it was 8. So that's 2 cycles for every color. Doable. Very doable. I don't want to make this table, though. But I can make something generate it for myself. Yeah, that wasn't so hard, was it? But yeah, I'm really lazy. So it's doing more than it needs to. Whatever. It's the table only needs to be 128 bytes, and I'm making it 256. And here's where I'm putting it. Why? Well, because I got lots of space here. And I can move it later. But anyways. I better fix that. But it doesn't work. Oh no. Okay, I was debating not showing you guys this at all, or any of the previous clips I just made. This is a big blunder. I'm such an idiot. Y needs to be what it is to keep track of everything. So why am I looking up shuffles based on Y? I need to look up shuffles based on A, but to do that I would have to change A to Y and then look it up. At which point Y is changed, and it can't be. This won't work. I am an idiot, but I'm leaving it in here. I'm showing you guys, hey, I screw up too, and when I do, it's delightfully stupid. Yeah, I feel a little silly about that end part, but hey, I'm not perfect, eh? In the next episode, I do come up with a way to save some cycles, and in doing so, I create a rather peculiar bug with an even more peculiar name. I'm embarrassed about it already. Anyway, until next time, I'm Loop Darksnow.